Hello and welcome to Software. I will not dwell too much about the Hera project itself. Please check the heraproject.eu website, in which you will have much more information about it. About the Hera software, you will normally download it as an archive, which is going to look like that. First thing to do is extract it. It will take a tiny bit of time because it's pretty big. And here we are. When you are inside the archive, you see that you have a hera.exe file that you should double-click on. Be aware that the software is only available on Windows. Starting the game, you have this menu where you can change the language. At the moment of making this video, only the English language is fully implemented, but soon all the languages of the consortium, which are Greek, Portuguese, Spanish, Danish and Estonian will be implemented. Some other languages will come after that. So I can change the language and I can also go here in the main menu. So this menu allows you to have contextual actions. For the moment, the only contextual action we have is exit, or you can also manage your audio. Meaning that if I want to have a little bit less sound, I will move around the main volume slider. If I want to have a little bit less or more music, I will move around this slider. And if I want to hear a bit more or less SFX, or if you prefer special effects, I will move around this slider. I can also try to change the quality of graphics displayed. Right now it's on fantastic by default, but look at the shadows here. They will disappear if I go to the fastest type of graphical quality. If you have an old computer or if the game is really, really slow, I would recommend that you use the fastest speed. Otherwise, the fantastic graphical quality is pretty nice. You can check at all times how many FPS, or if you prefer frame per second, you are displaying on your screen by clicking on this little toggle here. You see that right now I'm displaying 143 frames per second. Clicking on credits here will display all the people which have participated into this project. Now let's begin and authenticate. I want to show you first how we can use the software as a teacher and then as a student. So I will log in with my teacher account and we'll create a student account later. I am signing in and I'm arriving at this web interface, which is going to be one of the main interfaces of the game. Let me explain. You have three types: courses, scenario and public scenario. Scenarios are at the heart of the Hera game. What we call scenarios are specific situations in which we want teams of 1 to 4 students to work together, interact, and try to solve problems and manage to get to some objectives which are defined by the teacher. So this scenario tabs is a list of all the scenarios I have created myself. The public scenario tab is a list of all the publicly available scenarios that have been created by myself or other people and that I can also use. And the list of courses are where I'm actually putting my scenario, I'm slotting my scenario inside a course so that my students can actually use the scenario inside a certain structure. So let's begin by creating a scenario and let's see what we can do with it. So to create a scenario, it's very simple. You just simply click on the blue button here. You are prompted with a certain city name. I will call it tutorial. And you ask to select a size. I will recommend you select the medium size. It's big enough for the beginning. Then click on play and the actual in-game view will appear. So this map is generated randomly at the beginning. If you start the game and try yourself exactly what I've been doing, you will have a fully different map. On this map, I'm supposed to place my create my city, which is going to have certain issues that the students will need to solve. The first thing to do would be to access here the scenario editor. So in the scenario editor, I'm going to put the name of the scenario again, tutorial, and I'm going to select how many roles I want, or if you prefer, how many players I want to play my game. So Hera is a multiplayer game, meaning that all the players can play at the same time and it will share the same map. I'm going to have three players only. I can now select how much money the students are going to have at the beginning, and also how we are going to share this money. Is the money going to be common for everyone, or rather, are everyone going to have the same budget at the beginning, or are everyone going to have a very different budget specific to each of the role? That's up to you to select. I'm going to enter 50,000, which is going to be a common sum. I can also select everything which is time related. So, for starters, are we going to use seasons in our scenario, or are we going to have just one long season? That's up to you. If we are using season, in which season do you want to start? That's up to you too. You can also select if you want to use a night and day cycle. If you don't, it just means that you're going to have a very, very long day. Otherwise, you can also use weather or not. Weather are effects such as thunder, rain, snow, etc., etc. That will be displayed during the game. Now, something quite important is the scenario duration in days. So each scenario is going to last a certain number of in-game days. The scenario that you're creating is going to be inserted into a course. And this course is going to be lasting a certain number of real-life days. So let's say I want to have a course for the students, for my students, for 1 week. So 1 week, that's 7 days, and I will allow the students to play the game for 7 days in a row. And they will be able to play this game at any point they want in time. And they're going to be able to just log in, play, whether there's other students logged in or not. It's as they want. Why? Simply because the game is going to start, the scenario, to be precise, is going to start the very second that you created the course, and is going to stop at the date that you selected for the end of the course. So it's like the whole world of the scenario is evolving from the very beginning of the course to the end of the course. So to take my example before, let's say I have asked my student to work on this course for 7 days, and I'm saying that this scenario is during for 70 days in game. What does that mean? Well, it means that for every day I've asked the student to work on this scenario, 10 in-game days will elapse. So if I'm asking my students to start on a Monday and they don't start to play the game before, let's say, Wednesday, that means that when they start the game, it will be already day 30 of the scenario, and 20 days will have passed by without them playing. So this scenario duration is very important, and you need to think about what you want to show in your course. Right now, I'm going to put a full year. We have simplified things, so a year is actually 360 days and a season is 90 days only. We can also select if we want a flood event to happen. So if I don't, I'm just selecting none. And if I'm selecting the flood to happen, this will happen after a certain amount of in-game days. So if I select here 180 days, it means that the flood will happen exactly at halfway of the scenario, but right now I'm not interested in the flood. Here I can select for each of the three roles that I have. I can enter a name, and enter a lot of different characteristics. Let's see that. So let's say that my first player, my first role, is going to be a financial advisor for the mayor. So let me write it down. Okay, so I can here enter a description of the role. It should be a long description so the students know exactly what this role entails. And I can select as a teacher what the capacities of the roles are going to be. That means that all the different players won't have the same capacities. Some are going to be able to do a certain amount of things in the game. Some are going to be some other, going to be able to do some other type of things. Or you can also select the fact that everybody will be able to do everything. That's entirely up to you, teacher, to define the scenario as you want it. So for example, here, instead of giving all the rights to this student, he's a financial advisor. So let's say I'm going to make him only able to build and bulldoze commerce and nothing else. We have divided the different buildings of the game, or if you prefer, all the buildings available to you to create a city, into different amount of categories. We have housing, commerce, industries, infrastructures, public services, and culture. I will present you those categories a bit more in detail later. And we also allow for terraforming and zoning, but most important thing is going to be terraforming. I'll show you that later also. And the same way that you can build those different categories, you can also destroy them. So right now, I'm saying that my financial advisor is going to be able to build and destroy the different commerces. And then I can define some objective for this financial advisor. So what is his target in the game? Let's say I want that by the end of the scenario, we have a city treasury of 1 million. And I also want to be sure that the city expenses are going to be less than, let's say, 25,000. So those two objectives that I've just defined are going to be the target of this player for the entire game. Now if I define another one, which would be, I don't know, political advisor for the mayor, but again, you could define any role you want. What matters is what capacity they have. So let's say the political advisor is able to do everything, and just going to write a short description. Well, actually, you should write here a description of what the role exactly is. And I'm going to write that the objective of this rule is to have happiness of the city of the population, which is at least 85%. And then I can define a third rule, which would be environmental advisor, which is able to build industries and infrastructures and destroy them. And the target would be to reduce the overall pollution during the game. So to do that, I would say that the target here would be that the accumulated pollution is less than 50% for the water, air, and ground. So that would be the objectives of this player. As you can see, we can have very, very different objectives with very different capacities to reach those objectives. The entire point of the Hera game is to have players which have different types of interaction with the environment, which are working together and collaborating towards the objective of having everybody's managing to fulfill their own private objectives. So I've now defined my objectives. I can begin and create my town. For that, let's see the different tools that we have at the bottom. This is going to give me some information, but right now we have no building, so that's not going to be helping very much. With that button, I can bulldoze everything. So if I can select a big area, I'm going to destroy everything in this big area. This button is very useful because it allows you to access terraforming tools. With terraforming tools, you're able to completely modify the map that you have in front of you. So if I select the Modify Terrain tool, I am now able, with a left mouse click, to create mountains. And with a right mouse click, I'm able to actually depress the mountain and create lakes. So you can alter the geography of your town exactly as you see fit. The level terrain tool is going to help you have a more level terrain. So see here, I have a huge plain. So let's say I want to have an even bigger plain. I'm going to click on one element of the plain, and then I'm going to keep my mouse clicked and move around in order to have most of the map, which is going to become a plain. Or if I want to have a bigger lake, I could also select one tile at the bottom of the lake and then move about, and all the tiles around are going to be leveled to the level of the tile I selected first. I can also do the same with mountains, so it creates kind of a big plateau here, etc., etc. So thanks to the Modify Terrain and Level Terrain features, you should be able to transform the map exactly as you want. Next, you have housing. Housing comes in four categories, with small houses, medium ones, bigger ones, bigger ones, and then skyscrapers. All those houses have different characteristics. Of course, let's begin by creating a very tiny town. You can see immediately that when I'm creating the town, there's some icons which are popping up on top of the houses. We see a road icon and an electricity icon. That's simply because houses will require to have electricity and a road nearby to actually function. So right now I'm creating a town, yes, but nothing functions in this town. We need to have a bit more infrastructure in order for it to work. So I just created a tiny, tiny bit of town. And as you see, all my buildings have issues for the moment. I can use now my information tool and check what it says. Oh, I have a problem with roads and I have a problem with electricity. I also see that I have absolutely zero inhabitants for the moment, which is logical. And of course, the happiness is at zero too. So let's continue into what I can create for my town. And here I have farms, either organic or commercial farms. Let's create one big commercial farm here, or a couple of commercial farms. I also have some industries. I can have some metallurgic factories here. And I also have some recycling elements. So I have a recycling factory, I have an air treatment station, etc., etc. Let's put one recycling factory just right here. Commerce. If I want, I can have some commercial zones for my little town. Here I will build a big mall and maybe a small coffee shop. If I'm moving around, I can click on the right button of the mouse and this will rotate the building I'm going to place. So here I'm going to place some big office buildings, and as you can see, if I click on the left mouse button, I rotate the direction of the building I'm going to place. So here are a couple of office buildings, and that's it for commercial buildings. Now let's see what I can build into public services. In public services, I first have police, fire station, hospital, school. So let's build a police headquarter, maybe just right here, and a fire station, maybe here, and a hospital here. I can also create some buildings which are related to transportation, such as the bus stops, parking lots, airports. Let's create one small parking lot here. And let's create some park here. And finally, you will find everything which is related to getting rid of garbage in the public services tab. So let's go and create a trash disposal site here. For the moment, still nothing works at all. I can also create some cultural related buildings, such as a museum. Let's put it here. Now, let's have our town running. To do that, we need a lot of infrastructure. The first infrastructure will be roads. There are several types of roads. You have the very simple roads, a very elementary road, which is used to create connection between buildings. And then you have roads with bus lanes and bike lanes. The fact of having bus lane and bike lane creates variation in how much pollution or how much traffic there is on those roads. And you also have asphalt roads, which are exactly like normal roads, but are much better at absorbing water. So let's take a normal type of road and let's put roads everywhere. In order to very quickly put road everywhere, I just click and keep my mouse button clicked and I will be able to move about with my roads and they will be created very easily, the connection having to be done immediately. Right now I'm just going to remove the layer. I'm going to explain the layer system a bit later. So I'm creating my roads and you will see that very quickly none of the building which had the road sign on top of them are going to have it anymore. But they still have other issues. So the road issue is solved. As you can see, one of the blinking issues here is electricity. Some have a yellow type of thunder icon, some have an orange one, and it's related to generating power. There are three types of power in the game. We have low energy, medium energy, high energy. When you create a power plant, let's create a coal power plant somewhere, like here. When I create my coal power plant, what I'm doing is that I'm creating a source of high energy. I will then need to transform this high energy into medium energy to distribute it to all the buildings who need medium energy. Of course, I will need to create a road, otherwise the building will not work, as all the other buildings. So once I've created my road and source of energy, I can begin linking the buildings who need electricity together. Here I'm creating power lines and now the buildings are all powered. As you can see, I don't need to have a power line to each building. They are going to be part of a grid and that means that I just need to have one element of the grid which is powered, and then all of the elements of the grid are going to be powered automatically. So now I need to power the police headquarters here. I'm going to put some more cables, and I'm also going to need to power the museum. So I'm going to build some more cables. Perfect! So now I see I have a lot of power, and most of my town has electricity, but I still need low voltage power. So how to do that? Well, I need to transform the medium voltage to low voltage. In order to do that, I will create here a transformer. And you see that all the roads which require electricity are acting as power pylons and they are transmitting electricity. So I don't need to have any power pylons here anymore for the houses. They are automatically getting the electricity from the road. So the number of problems I'm having is going down, down, down. Perfect. Let's see what is the next possible tab in the infrastructure. It's everything about internet. So to have internet in your town, you should create an ISP core building. Let's create it here. And once you have created it, you need to actually put some fiber lines, fiber optic lines, into your town in order to have all your building getting optic fiber. Again, it works with the concept of a grid. So if two elements are touching, they will be able to share the connection to internet. So here, for example, my parking lot is not connected to internet, my park is not connected to internet, my garbage disposal site is not connected to internet, but that's not very important, is it? I can also connect to internet my farms, and here the power plants and the different converters. Okay, my town is now pretty much entirely connected to internet. I can also have a cell phone network. If I want, I can create a cell phone network by placing antennas. So I'm going to place an antenna, let's say here and here. So as you can see, an antenna has only a certain array, so maybe I will need to place some more antennas, but each of the antenna actually requires to have access to internet, which means I need to dig a bit more and give a bit more internet access. And now if I'm looking at my cell phone, well, my entire town is covered except those buildings, but we'll keep it this way for the moment. So now we have entirely functional town, and I want to show you here the overlay system that we have and how that will help you to understand what is going on in your town. So as I was saying before, you have this information tool, which is extremely useful because it will give you in-depth information about each of the building. Here, for example, you can see that the fire station is not working right now because well, there's not enough people to actually manage and use it. So we have a problem with not having enough inhabitants in our town, which is normal because we just built it. As time will fly, more and more people will come, and this will make the fire station functional. For the moment, it doesn't work, but we can see it's connected with roads, it has electricity, garbage disposal is okay, it has phone, and the integrity of the building is 100% here, and everything is okay. So all is working well in the fire station, except that we don't have enough population for the moment. But let's say, okay, it's nice to have information about one building, but what about information about all the buildings? In order to do that, you need to use a layer system. So the layer system is going to show you information for the entire town. So for energy, at a glance, you can see which part of the energy have which part of the town, sorry, have low voltage energy, which part of the town have medium voltage energy, and which part of the town have high voltage. Regarding pollution, here you can see what part of the town is producing heavy ground pollution. Unsurprisingly, it's around the industries. Heavy air pollution, unsurprisingly, it's around the coal factory. Water pollution, here it's around the farms, and noise pollution around the factories mainly. We can also see where we have some wind. Most of the time it will be linked to having some mountains. The more mountains you have, the stronger winds you have. We can see the communications. Do we have internet everywhere? Do we have cell phone everywhere? We can see also the health coverage. For the moment, because the hospital is still not functional, not enough people in it, we have just a park, which is giving us a tiny bonus of health. We can see the amount of culture, which will be centered around the museum, but for the moment, the museum is not functional because there's not enough people. We can see the amount of crime which is committed in the town. So as you can see, it's pretty high around industries or when you have lots of habitations together. We can see the police coverage. For the moment, it's not covered because, again, not enough people in the town. And the public safety, which is basically crime minus police coverage. We can also see education, which is going to be created by schools and universities. We can see how much tourism we have. For the moment, a tiny bit around the park. How much traffic there is in the town. What is the parking capacity of the different units we have? Right now, we can see we have a tiny bit of parking capacity here simply because those are houses which have an integrated garage. We can also check fire protection, again for the moment offline. We can check then how much revenue we're going to get globally and for each of the industrial, commercial and others category, how much maintenance we're going to have to pay globally and for each of the categories. We can check also how much population we have and where it is concentrated. We can check happiness. We can check public transportation. For the moment, we don't have any. We can check the garbage collection or if some garbage is piling up. And we can check the integrity of the buildings. The whiter, the better here. So that's our layer system, which is going to be very helpful for us to get information about our town. We can also use this button here, underground or not, to see what is under the surface. So if I click on underground, I see those thin blue lines, which are all the fiber optic cables which are laid for internet. Okay, so now you have an overview of how to build a town and how to manage it. Let's see some other tools which are very useful for teachers in order to create specific situation. The layer editor. So the layer editor, the idea behind it is that maybe you will want to create a scenario where one part of the town is going to be having a very big problem of crime, or maybe one part of the town is especially well situated, so it's going to give you much more taxes. So basically, with layer system, we want to allow teachers to create special zone, specific zone, which will help with the narrative that you have in your scenario, and which will also help with creating very specific situation. So let's say our custom layer is going to be about crime. So here I can define up to 3 layers, and in each layer I can define up to 6 different zones. So in my crime layer, my layer number 1, I can now define zones. So I'm going to define a zone which is going to be high crime, and I'm going to say it's red, and it's going to give me plus 20 in crime. Then I can add another zone which is low crime, which is going to be green, and it's going to give me minus 30 in crime. So now that I have those two zones, I can go here on this little button, custom layer, and paint on the map where I'm going to have those zones. So here I'm painting the high crime and I'm painting the low crime zone. So now I have defined that on the map, this part of the city will have especially low crime, this part of the city will have especially high crime. And you can define up to 6, as you can see those 4 here are completely empty because I only defined 2 types of zone, and you can define up to 3 layers. So in total it means that you can have a total of 6 by 3, 18 different zones. You can check those zones in the overlay at each and any moment. They are going to be called C1, C2, C3, like custom 1, custom 2, custom 3. Here C1 corresponds to my layer 1, the crime layer. Okay, so I have now created my town. It's more or less functional. It will take a bit of time to be fully functional. And I also have defined my different objective, my different roles and my different objectives. I want now to save and exit. So I have my tutorial, and as you can see, the roles are here appearing, and I can define also a few more elements. Let me show you. If I click on edit, I can now add some tags. Let's say I want to add a tutorial tag. What is the point of having a meta tag? It's going simply to help you remember what the scenario is about. And if you make the scenario public, it's going to help everybody else understand what your scenario is about. I can define the language in which I'm going to create this tutorial. Here it's in English. but I can select actually any type of language. If I entered my scenario in French, I would select the French language here. I can now select if it's going to be a private or a public type of scenario. For the moment, we keep it private, and I'm saving. So here you see the tutorial tag is now here. If I wanted to search into my list of scenarios, I could search my scenarios by language. So if I select all Greek ones, for the moment, I don't have any, so I have zero. If I wanted to have only my English ones, well, they're all English, so that's my English scenarios. Or I could also say that I just want the scenario which are called massive. So I see I have actually two towns which are called massive. And I could also look and select by tags. That's a different way of finding them. You can also look and find the public scenario in the same fashion, by name, by tag, or by flag. Now that I have created my tutorial scenario, I want to create a course using it. So in order to do so, I'm going to click on Create New Course. Automatically, the system has created a code. So this code is very important because that is the code you're going to give to your students when you will tell them to actually create. So let me write it down. I'm going to use Notepad++. I'm going to create a new sheet, and here I'm having this code. Okay, I've wrote it down. So let's go back to the game. Here I'm going to give a name for my course. So using the tutorial scenario, I can write a description, tutorial course, and I can also write learning objective and expected learning outcomes if I want to. The same way that we have meta tags for the scenario, I can have meta tags for my course too. I can select the language of my course, and very important, I need here to select which scenario I'm going to use. The list of scenario directly comes from the scenarios which are here in my private scenarios. So if you wanted to take a public scenario and put it into a course, don't forget to first copy it so it appears in the private scenarios. So let's use my tutorial scenario. And then, very important, I have a starting date and an ending date. Remember that the starting date and ending date will have a direct effect on how time flows inside your scenario. Okay, so I'm saving, and I have my using the tutorial scenario. Let's click on it to go into it. You see that that's my name because I'm the author, and that's the code which I'm supposed to give to my students. And here is my list of students. For the moment, it's fully empty, of course. It's just been created. I can click on course setting to access the settings we just saw, or more importantly, I can now create new teams. I need to create one team per group of students I want to use the game. So I can create, I don't know, if I have 10 teams here now, I will need to create 10 teams, but I'm a bit lazy, so I'm just going to show you for a couple of teams. Now that I've created a team, you see that I have one block here per team, and I can access to three things: post-its, agile, and game. Well, post-its are a system of notes that students can leave to each other, so they can create, or I can leave as a teacher, because I just created the course, so maybe I want to leave some instructions to my students. Hello, play and have fun, for example. And I can select a color. I can now add a video if I want. If I had a YouTube video, for example, I could insert it here. If I have an image that I want to insert, I could also insert an image here. I can basically have multimedia type of notes here. So I'm saving it, and I can put it wherever I want. Because I'm a teacher, I'm also allowed to do that. That means that I have locked down my note and nobody can touch it anymore. So I can leave instructions and be sure that the students won't destroy them. So I've left my little instruction here in the post-it. All the students, by the way, can leave notes here. So that's one way for them to coordinate. Another way for them to coordinate would be to use the chat. Being a teacher, I don't have access to the chat system, but there is a chat system for the students. We'll see that later. And I could also use the agile component. So what is the agile component? The agile component allows me to create tasks and to color code them if I want to. And then it's up to the students to actually, here I'm going to add columns, here, wait, I'm going to change the color, okay. So maybe instead of task, I should have said that this should be player one, this should be player two. Okay, and now player two, I'm going to put it in blue. Okay, so now I have three different type of legend, and I can create here the different tasks and say that well, task one, and I can attribute it to, I can color code it, and I can also attribute it to players. Of course, that is only if they want to use the system, but basically they have this whole agile system of being able to have tasks that they can color code in any way they want. So that's the agile system, and then if I click on game, I will experience the game like my students are experiencing it. As you can see, we're starting at night, so that's the night aspect of the game. The city is lit, except for the buildings which are not functioning right now. Oh, this one just started to function. So here we still have the problem of habitation, and we need to wait a little bit for some population to come in order for those buildings to be functional. Okay, so that's what I can see from the teacher point of view. Now let's try and be a student. So I'm going to start the game again and log in as a student. But for that, I'm going to create an account first. When creating an account, oh, just one second, I'm going to diminish the volume of the music here. Better this way. So I'm just asked for a username, a password, a first name and last name, but the first name and the last name are fully optional, and a special code. This special code corresponds to the teacher code, which is going to be only for teachers. So now let's say I want to be student20, with the password being student20. And as easy as that, I have registered and I've created my account. Now I can log in as student20. Signing in. Of course, I have absolutely zero courses for the moment, so I want to join a course. Let's join the course I've just created. Remember that that was the code. So normally this code is given to me by the teacher. So I'm going to insert the code here and I'm joining. Now I have joined the course that I created before. And I can access to the brainstorming, so which is the post-it zone, the zone with notes. I can have access to the agile zone that we saw before. I can have access to the role, to the game, sorry, and I can select my role. Of course, first I should join a team, otherwise it's going to be complicated to play. So now I've joined a team. I see that some of the different icons here, buttons, have lit up. Now I can access the brainstorming and I can see the message that I've left before. I can access the chat and I can leave chat messages for my colleagues. I can access the agile zone, And I can access the game, but I can't access the game right now because here they tell me please choose a role first. So let's do that. I need to click here and I see what are the roles which are existing. There's a political advisor, there's a financial advisor, and there's an environmental advisor. And as you can see here, you should have your long description which corresponds to the role. So let's say I'm going to be environmental advisor. Okay. Okay. Role chosen, so that's good. Go back. And now that I have chosen my role, I can actually play the game. By the way, you see here that I am enrolled into the game here, into the course, sorry, and I'm one of the students which is registered. So let's play the game. I am starting, as you can see, at midnight 43. That's because I haven't started the game at the very moment the course was created. At the very moment the course was created, the game started at midnight, actually, exact. So I am 1 in-game hour after the course was created. Here you can see my city at night. It's getting lit up. And slowly but certainly, my population will rise. What should I do as... What is my objective? Ah, I can see here what are the objectives. Not only for me, I'm role number 3, so I should keep the accumulated air pollution, ground pollution under 50. For the moment, I'm way in the green because I'm only at 2% pollution, 4% pollution, and 0% pollution for the water, so I can develop my industry much more. But I can also see the roles of the other players. I can see who, what is the role of player 2, and they need to have 80% of happiness. Right now they have much more, and they also, I can see the role of objective 1, and I see obviously the city needs to develop to have a much better treasury. Right now the expenses are in the green. We're good. We shouldn't reach 25%. We're 25,000, sorry, we're way under, but treasury wise we're also way under, so we will need to develop this town a lot. But we'll need to develop this town while maintaining happiness and while keeping all the pollution very low. So it's going to be something which will require everybody to work together harmoniously and to try to really synergize in order for them to be able to work out what they want to do. Here you can see that I only have access to the industry tab and to the infrastructure tab. How come? Simply because as a teacher, I defined that the player which was going to play as the environmental advisor would only have access to those two possible types of buildings. So that's it. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I also hope that you're going to play the game and enjoy it a lot. Thank you very much for your attention, and bye-bye.